like to move to the first session. For the first session with the topic of a principle and development of irrigation system, I would like to introduce Associate Professor Dr. Varavut Vuthivanit. Dr. Varavut Vuthivanit graduated in civil engineering at Colorado State University, USA, in PhD. Now he is a senior lecturer at Irrigation Engineering at Department. He has taught in the department more than 40 years and has a lot of experience in irrigation, water resources area with many research projects. So please welcome Dr. Varavut Vuthivanit, and we will start the first session now. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ketvala, for giving introduction about myself. Okay, before we start the first lecture, I would like to ask you, can you hear my speaking?
Yes, I can.
Is it clear enough?
Yes.
Yeah, because in the opening, the voice is too low in some part. So I would like to make sure that what I'm saying, you can hear very clear. Okay. Welcome all of you to the first session in this international training course. And I would like to say good morning to everybody and welcome all of you to my course. Okay, actually I heard from the opening that the participant is about 34. But right now is less than 20. Anyway, we will move on to this lecture. I don't really like the online training course like this because I don't have chance to meet you directly. Actually, in international training course, we will have a kind of welcome party before start any lecture. And that time we can drink a coffee and talk to each other, familiar with each other before we start. Okay, before I start my lecture, I would like to ask you, do you have a background on irrigation engineering? Maybe somebody tell me. Anybody's got a degree in irrigation engineering or agricultural engineering with major in irrigation or water resource? Okay, let me ask directly. For the first one I saw today, Mr. Sami Salim Al Abdali from Oman. This is the first face I saw in this online course.
Hello, Doctor. Hello. I have engineering and also I work in water resource.
Oh, you work in water resource. So you must have some background on irrigation already.
Yeah.
Okay, good. How about Arthur? The other one, Ahmed, which your face is look very similar to Abadi from Oman.
Yeah, Doctor. I have background in irrigation engineering and agriculture also.
Oh, very good. Where are you from?
From Oman.
Oman also, okay, two from Oman. That's why your face look very similar. when I saw a small picture and you dress up very similar.
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe you are twin. Okay, let's talk to another one from South Africa. How many people from South Africa? Mr. Mashaba. Did I pronounce right?
Yes, right. Now,
turn on your camera so that we can see each other.
I stuck here. I can't. We have load shedding.
Ah, okay, okay.
Electricity at the moment.
Okay, okay.
Yes.
You have a background on irrigation engineering or agricultural engineering?
Agricultural engineering. Okay. I did not do anything on engineering, but I just did some modules on agricultural.
Okay. So today we will start with the topic of irrigation principle and development. Okay, let me. Okay, irrigation principle and development. Okay, can you see my PowerPoint?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I see.
Okay, okay. My name's Walawut Puthivanit. I have been working in Department of Irrigation Engineering since 1980. It's really long time. From 1980 up to now is more than 40 years. Okay. The topic of irrigation principle and development. What I try to pick up the topic to talk to you today is the basic irrigation principle. And I will talk a little bit on development because development is kind of too complicated to be discussed in the class. And this is the outline of the topic that I'm going to deliver to you. Yeah, first, I will give you some introduction about irrigation, how important is irrigation. And then go to soil water plant relationship, irrigation scheduling. These two topics are related to each other. And then I will go to crop water requirement, yield response to water. And then if we have time, I will introduce some computer program, some web application to you. The program is called WAT. If you have been working in field of irrigation, I think you should know CropWAT. CropWAT is not a new software. It's really old, has been developed, I think, since 1990, and even before that. But people start familiar with CropWAT in 1990. After CropWAT has changed from the DOS version to Windows version. And there are two web applications. First one is Irisep. This web application was developed by a university and some agency in Australia. I think this is really good. And the last web application is iWASM. This is the web application that developed by Department of Irrigation Engineering. And I'm part of the people who developed this. iWASM is not completed yet. It's starting. But if I have time, I will show you something about what I have been done on iWASM. And then we go to irrigation method and irrigation development, the last topic. Anyway, these are kind of, I think, basic irrigation topics. But if you already know about this topic, we can skip it and discuss what you want. Okay, if you don't mind, I will follow the outline that I'm giving you. But anyway, if you think this is you don't want to know anymore because you already have a lot of experience on this, already have a lot of knowledge on this, then we can skip. During my lecture, if you have any question, if you want to comment anything, you can speak right away. You don't need to keep it until I finish my lecture. Okay? You feel free to discuss me, because I don't want you to waste your time during 2.5 hours with me. I would like to give you as much as I can, so that you will not be disappointed after this course. Okay? Okay, about these topics, if you would like me to focus on which one, please tell. Okay? Okay, irrigation was originated many thousand years ago in Mesopotamia. I think many of you already know Mesopotamia because you're coming from that area. Mesopotamia in the map is here. Now it's become, Mesopotamia is an ancient kingdom, ancient world, but now become Iraq, Syria, and some part of Turkey, and maybe some other country also. The main river basin in Mesopotamia is Euphrates and Tigris. I saw some participants from Iraq also, and from Syria also. You are coming from the origin of irrigation. Irrigation in many countries is defined as O-art, art not science. S-O as civilization. But for the whole world, it is a modern science of survival. This is why irrigation is important. This statement was given by a very expert from India. Why irrigation is important? I think you already know irrigation is important. Because irrigation is the way to increase productivity. That is a key word. Irrigation can increase productivity, which is really need nowadays. Particularly, the world nowadays has so many problems. The first one is climate change. I would like to tell you that before I don't feel directly that climate is changing until this year. The weather in Thailand during the past few months changed rapidly. We have a heavy rainfall a few weeks before end of dry season, which has never been like this before. And many rain after some rain, like last week, after rain, the wind blow like a winter season. This is I can feel directly at my home. So irrigation is important because irrigation will be more important because of climate change. And a thing that makes irrigation more important is the requirement for food security of the world, increased population, and limited fresh water resource. And particularly nowadays, COVID-19 make irrigation more important also. Okay, I would like to give you a short definition about irrigation. And this definition is my definition. Based on my experience teaching course in irrigation for almost half a century. Irrigation is science and technology of water application to increase crop yield. Increase crop yield, why it is important, I already mentioned to you. Okay, irrigation is related to water application. Sound really simple. Irrigation is water application. Everybody know how to apply water to crop. Suppose you have one crop or one plot like this. You don't need to know much about irrigation. You can apply water. If you have many plants, many plots like this, it will be more difficult. If you have limited water resource, limited other resources, labors, monies, equipment, so apply water to these plants will be more difficult. But if you have a large field, and many large fields, many large fields, growing different kinds of crops, water application become more complex. But if you have to be a manager of irrigation system like this, so this picture I show you is McLong irrigation system, the second largest irrigation system in Thailand. McLong irrigation system has the command area above 300,000 hectares. Because system is so large, it's divided into 10 sub-projects, 10 irrigation projects. Yeah, like this one project, you see. You can see different color represent different projects. And the red line is canal irrigation system that can convey water from McLong. McLong is the name of the river. And distribute to 300,000 hectares. So water application in this large-scale system can be very complicated. Not as simple as you have one plot of plant. Thailand nowadays, we have almost 5 million hectares of irrigation land spread around the country in all the region. So management of irrigation become more difficult and more complex. Okay. The question related to irrigation that I would like you to know how to answer after you finish my course, my lecture. The question related to irrigation is, when to irrigate? Very simple question, when to irrigate? How much water should be applied? So the first two questions related to what we call irrigation scheduling. When to irrigate, how much water should be applied? And this is the first principle that we have to teach irrigation engineering students. You have to know how to decide when to irrigate. You have to know how to estimate how what water should be applied. The third question is how to apply water efficiently. Because now water is limited. Fresh water is limited. And water has a cost, not free. You have to develop water resource, construct canal network, in order to convey water from source to farm. And cost of irrigation water nowadays keep increasing. The fourth is irrigation water requirement. How we can estimate irrigation water requirement? For one field like this, it is not difficult. But if you have like this, 300,000 hectare, 300,000 hectare make consists of 100,000 farms. How that 100,000 field, which grow different crops. So irrigation water requirement require to estimate irrigation water requirement require a lot of data. And then finally, crop yield response to water. If we apply water not suitable, it means some period of growth, there is a water stress take place that will affect the yield. If you can control irrigation at optimal level for the whole growth period, then you will get optimum yield. But if you cannot do that, then the yield will be reduced. You need to know crop yield response function. How we can estimate yield response? Okay, like I said before, that irrigation is to increase crop yield. So the figure I show you is just, I don't know if it is a real or not. It looks too good. Yeah, if you have like this apple, this much, if you can grow like this, you'll be rich farmers. This is durian. You know, one piece of durian in Thailand costs maybe, let's say, 500 baht. You have one tree of durian like this with 100 of them. So you can sell at, you can get a lot of money. And this is papaya. You see, this is the kind of what farmer want. And if you know irrigation principle, then you can increase crop yield. So look at some news or some statistic about crop yield. So I will focus on rice. China set new world record for rice yield. China claim that now they can produce 7.2 ton per hectare. How do you think about this number? This is high, medium, or low? For me, it's very high. And I will show you. And this is Statistica. Statistic from US a few years ago. In the graph behind, you can see that this is a yield of rice in different states in USA. The average is 7,580 pounds per acre. When I convert to ton per hectare, it's only 8.6. USA can produce only 8.6. China claim that they can get 7.2, a lot higher, double. And this is a man from India named Kumar. He said he can produce 22.4 ton. Every country try to show their statistic that they can produce highest yield in the world. Thailand also, one guy said he can produce more than 30 ton ton per hectare. But no actual evidence. I try to search where is his farm? Can he make that high, very high yield in reality, or just faking? But I cannot have any chance to see whether it is true or not. Okay, let's see some real statistics. I got this statistic from our world in data. Our in data has a yield of agricultural yield, all kinds of agricultural yield, since 1961 to 2018. This is the rice yield. The figure I show is, you can see that rice yield keep increasing from 1960 to now. And I pick up 10 countries. Unfortunately, when I pick up this data, I did not know that, but some participants come from Oman. Then I have a question to you. You can see that from these 10 countries, Oman produce highest rice yield. Oman is number one nowadays. United States, China. So 7.2 is just maybe some news only, not the average production of China. And then Vietnam, Indonesia, Colombia, Laos, Philippines, India, and Thailand. Thailand is the last in the 10 countries that I show the rice yield. Yield of Thailand on the average now is only 2.29 ton per hectare. Then I come to the question that why do you come to participate international training course on irrigation in Thailand? We are the country that produce almost the lowest yield among participants country in this course. Oman is number one. You should organize irrigation training course. Even Vietnam, Indonesia, I suppose, in Philippines, these are participants in this course. But one thing, if you look at this trend of rice production, you can see that for Oman, it's very, very strange that all of the sudden 1990, you jump two times. And then a little bit decreasing from 1990 to 2010, and then jump again. You see, until now is number one among these 10 countries. Is it true? I asked a participant from Oman, Ahmed, is it true that your rice yield now is 13.35 ton per hectare? Mr. Ahmed.
Yes, Professor.
Is it true?
Well, this is first time I hear this information, actually.
Okay, never mind. But this is kind of interesting. If you can, like this, you say, you can double your yields.
Yeah.
That's really amazing. In 1990 and almost 1910, and then again, three times already. If you can jump like this, maybe your country is world number one. Okay, but anyway, although among these 10 countries, Thailand has lowest yield. But Thailand is one of the top five rice exporter to the world. This is something amazing. we got low yield, but we are top exporter, top five, always top five. Some year we are number one, some year number two, number three, number four. But nowadays, I think number one is India, followed by Thailand or Vietnam. It depends on statistics and depend on the climate condition in the country. During the last few years, we faced a very serious drought. Water resource is limited. Then rice production is prohibited in some area, in some season. That's why rice production is reduced. Okay. Besides rice, this is a kind four main crop in Thailand. Rice, like I told you before that, our yield is not, it's not much. Actually, it's low compared to other countries. But we are top five, always in top five exporter of rice. For sugar cane, our yield is even not top, but it's okay. 76 ton per hectare. Cassava is also okay. Corn or maize is about medium. Okay. Irrigation is science and technology of water application to increase crop yield. Now come to the question that, do you have any idea about your country that how much irrigation can increase crop yield? Anybody have any idea about your country? Irrigation and can increase crop yield 2 times, 3 times, 4 times? Okay, if you still not answer me, I would like to you to see some report. I would like, this is from FAO report. FAO report said that, actually report like this many years ago, but still the statement is not changed. FAO said 40% of crop production, 40% of world crop production produced by 20% of cultivated area. And this cultivated area means irrigation area. From this statement, I try to figure out how much irrigation can increase crop yield. Not for rice, not sugarcane, not cassava, not corn, but for all agricultural, all crop production. So from this statistic, irrigated area, 20% of cultivation area, produce 40% of yield. So rain-fed area is 80%. Can produce only 60%. From this statistic, I figure out that irrigated yield, ratio of irrigated yield to rain-fed yield is about 2.7. So this show important that irrigation can increase crop yield, and it is a fact. Because this statement is reported by FAO. Okay, now come to Thailand statistic on agriculture. I just got this statistic from Office of Agricultural Economics. Good. Now, Thailand has the cultivated area about 24 million hectare. 500 million hectare is irrigated. And 46% of this area is rice cultivation area. And irrigated rice is about 25% of this total area. And I got this rice production in Thailand in 2021. Irrigated rice, this is yield of irrigated rice in wet season, rain-fed rice. If you use these two figures to figure out how much irrigation can increase crop yield, can increase rice yield, it's come up to be 1.5. So irrigated rice, irrigation increased crop yield in wet season in Thailand, maybe not as much as crop production of the whole world. Why? Because Thailand is in tropical country. In wet season, some farmer can grow, can cultivate rice without irrigation because we have quite good rainfall. But anyway, irrigation still increase crop yield by 1.5. Because during July to August, it's a period of, we call that period, rainfall is too little. If we don't have irrigation, rice may have a problem. But in dry season, yield is increasing. And in dry season, we cannot cultivate rice in dry season in rain-fed area. This means for dry season, ratio of irrigated rice to rain-fed rice is a lot higher than in wet season. Okay. Crop production can be increased by irrigation. This is fact. I can show you some FAO statistic and Thai statistic. So understand irrigation principle will help you increase crop yield by reduce water shortage. Okay, basic irrigation principle that I would like to introduce in this lecture is first, when to irrigate, how much water should be applied. And these two topics related to what we call irrigation scheduling. And the third principle is how to apply water efficiently. This topic we call irrigation method. In order to answer these three questions, first, you have to learn about soil-water-plant relationship. This is a science, basic science related to irrigation, soil-water-plant relationship. Okay. When we are talking about soil water, irrigation engineer will know that there are three types of soil water. The first one we call gravitational water, or you can call free water. Second is capillary water. The last one is hygroscopic water. Okay, I can explain these three types of soil water like this. This is a type of structure of the soil, which you can see that soil has three components. The first one, the brown one, is we call solid or soil particle. Among soil particle is the space, we call pore space. Inside pore space can be water, or air. So there are three components in soil. Soil particle, water, and air. After rain or irrigation, all pore space are filled with water. When all pore space are filled with water, water in a large pore space can move downward like this by gravity. This part of water we call gravitational water or free water. Water in large pore space move downward by gravity, gravitational force. That's why we call free water. This water can move freely. Okay, after gravitational water has been drained out of the soil, it will take maybe a few hours for a coarse texture soil, like sandy soil. It may take a few days for fine texture soil. It depends on texture of the soil. After gravitational water has been drained out of the soil, the water level is said to be at fill capacity. I will explain later. Okay, after gravitational water is drained, the remainder water in soil is capillary water and hygroscopic water. By these figures, you can see hygroscopic water is the water in a small pore space, or we call micropore. Water held in micropore is capillary water. This water can move by capillary action. Water move by capillary action means water will move from the zone of low soil moisture tension to the zone that have higher soil moisture tension. Or simply, water will flow or will move from the dry part, from the wetter part of the soil to the drier part of the soil. Capillary water is called available water, because plants can absorb this water. That's why we call available water. After capillary water has been used up, maybe by plant or by evaporation from soil surface, after capillary water has been removed from the soil, the soil moisture level will be at permanent wilting point. And the remainder water is hygroscopic water. Hygroscopic water is the water that held very tight to soil particle as a very, very thin film. This part of water cannot remove by plant. That's why we call unavailable water. So gravitational water, we call free water, it exists in the soil after rain or irrigation for few hours to few days, depend on soil texture. Capillary water is the water, soil water, between fill capacity and permanent wilting point. And this water we call available water. And the last part is hygroscopic water, which is unavailable to plant. You can remove hygroscopic water only by put this soil into the oven. Set temperature at 100.5 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. Then you can remove all hygroscopic water. But plant cannot take this. Okay? Okay. Now, you already know three types of soil water and fill capacity, permanent wilting point. Fill capacity is soil moisture level after gravitational loss. Water is drained out of the soil. Permanent wilting point is the point where available water already been consumed. Okay, so soil moisture that is important to irrigation is between fill capacity and permanent wilting point or capillary water. Okay, now to do irrigation scheduling, to answer when to irrigate, how much water should be applied. First, you know three types of soil water, gravitational water. This one, gravitational water, and this one, green and pink. This one is capillary water. The red one we call hygroscopic water. After rain or heavy rainfall, or after rain or irrigation, open space may be filled with water. Soil moisture level at that time we call saturation. No air in the soil. Only water in pore space. We call saturation. After gravitational water is removed, soil moisture level is at fill capacity. Gravitational water will be removed from the soil within few hours to few days, depend on the soil texture. Because of this, we call gravitational water as excess water. Excess water means water that is excess the requirement of crop. In irrigation, we don't need this excess water. Irrigation need available water, is mean water that is available to crop, this one. But anyway, when soil moisture level is at fill capacity, soil moisture tension is low, so plant can extract water from soil easily. But when soil moisture decreasing, when soil moisture decreasing, soil moisture tension increasing. Up to some certain level, soil moisture tension increase until plant root have difficulty to extract water from the rhizome. And stress, water stress begin. Yeah, that's why, because in the zone of available water, we divide into zone, optimal zone and stress zone. It means when water level drop below critical point, plant will stress. So by this knowledge, you can answer easily when to irrigate. Irrigation will start when soil moisture drop to critical point. And critical point is depend on type of crop. not depend on soil, depend on crop, type of crop, and the stage of growth. Critical point can vary from crop to crop. High water sensitive crop, critical point will be high. Like vegetable, high water sensitive, critical point is high. But for upland crop, low water sensitive, critical point can be lower. Depend on crop. So when to irrigate, in order to tell when to irrigate, you need to know critical point for your crop. And then how much water should be applied? You should apply water back to field capacity. If you apply more, it become excess water, not much useful. So this is optimum soil moisture level for irrigation. Field capacity, critical point. So optimal irrigation scheduling is to control soil moisture between critical point and field capacity. Water should be applied when soil moisture drop to critical point. The amount of water applied equal to amount of water to refill soil moisture back to field capacity. Okay, this is a kind of concept. This is kind of a principle that the first principle that you need to know. When do you irrigate? How much water should be applied? But in order to calculate, to have a figure that when to irrigate, how much water should be applied, you have to know more about soil water. Okay, based on this diagram, the soil moisture between permanent wilting point and field capacity, which before we call capillary water, but for irrigation management, we call total available water. TAW. And soil moisture between field capacity and critical point, we call readily available water. Actually, this is wrong writing. It should be RAW, not M. TAW, total available water. Readily available water. Okay.
And excuse me, doctor.
Yes.
I have a question.
Yeah, please.
Which related to, I'm not quite sure about the term of field capacity and critical point. And okay. How to define it and how can we know when the water is reached to the critical point or field capacity or something like that?
Okay, let's this way. Field capacity, according to the definition, field capacity is soil moisture level after gravitational water has been removed. How can we determine field capacity of your soil? Field capacity is the property of soil. If you have sandy soil, loam soil, clay soil, field capacity are different. Okay, there are two ways to determine field capacity. The basic way is, okay, you take a soil sample from your field. To take soil water, soil sample have to be undisturbed sampling technique. You need some equipment to take soil sample. And then you apply water until that soil sample is saturated. Okay. And put that soil sample in the air. Gravitational water will be moved out of the sun within few hours to few days. Not exactly. You see, when you can see that there is no drain out of the bottom of soil sample, it means gravitational water already removed. Then you can do soil moisture measurement by put this soil water into oven. You wait soil plus water first, and then put in oven to remove all water. And then you can, when you compare the before weight of soil before put in oven and after, you will know how much water in the soil. And then you can calculate how much is fuel capacity. But if you have equipment, because soil moisture extraction instrument in the irrigation school will have this kind, or even soil laboratory school, soil laboratory will have this equipment, soil moisture extraction. You saturate soil sample, put in the instrument, and apply some pressure. Fuel capacity is defined technically as soil moisture level at soil moisture tension equal to 0.10 bar. If you have equipment, then you can measure exactly. But if you don't have, you can use your observation. Okay, fuel capacity is the property of soil. But critical point is not property of soil, it's property of crop. Suppose maize will have some critical point. Other crop has different critical point. I will show you some figures about I will show you the soil property related to fuel capacity. I will show you critical point from the literature, particularly FAO report. FAO has reported critical point for many crop in the world. Okay, before we go to that, first you need to know this. RAW, TAW. This is TAW, total available water. RAW, readily available water, is the water between fuel capacity and critical point. Okay. RAW, not M, I'm sorry. Sometimes I just confuse using M as moisture or W as water. The meaning is not different. RAW, the meaning in irrigation is allowable depletion. It means how much soil moisture that you allow to be depleted before you start irrigation. That is the meaning of readily available water. When you divide readily available water to total available water, you got depletion fraction. And you can see that RAW is like this. TAW is larger. High sensitive crop, critical point is high. Low water sensitive is low. So depletion fraction P less than 1, depending on crop time. Okay, now we go to I will give you the answer about the property of fuel capacity and critical point more. Before we go to that, I would like you to know the some formula first. Maybe we can go quickly on this. Okay, this is a three components of soil. Soil particle or soil solid, water and air. On this side, we define mass. Mass of air, mass of water, mass of soil particle, and this is total mass. Actually, mass of air is negligible. In terms of volume, we have volume of air, volume of water, volume of soil particle. Volume of air and water we call void volume. This V is void. V-O-I-D, void volume. And this is total volume. Okay. Okay. The basic soil moisture property is that you need to know is AS, apparent specific gravity, no unit. Apparent specific gravity is the ratio of mass of solid part divided by mass of water, which has the volume equal to total volume of soil. This term, apparent specific gravity. And dB is bulk density. Bulk density has unit of gram per cc or cubic centimeter. Is mass of solid part divided by total volume. This one, ms divided by this. And n porosity is a percent of volume of void divided by total volume. Unit weight of water is 1 gram per cc. Okay, to calculate soil moisture, we define this. Theta m is mean percent soil moisture by dry mass. Theta v, percent soil moisture by volume. Small d, depth of soil moisture, or depth of water in soil in millimeter. Capital D, depth of loose soil. So to calculate soil moisture in percent by dry mass equal to 100 multiplied by mass of water divided by mass of soil particle. Soil moisture in percent by volume equal to volume of water divided by total volume multiplied by 100. Or we can write another question, another formula for the percent by volume like this. Percent by volume equal to percent by dry weight multiplied by apparent specific gravity. Depth of water in soil, small d, equal to percent by volume multiplied by depth of the loose soil divided by 100. Okay, now we come to a soil property. You ask me how can you find fill capacity. In this table, fill capacity, permanent melting point, porosity, and apparent specific gravity vary according to the soil texture. Soil texture, like sand, sandy loam, clay loam, silty clay. This diagram used for soil texture classification. If you are not familiar with this diagram, I would like to explain a little bit. In order to define texture of the soil, and if you know texture of the soil, then you know approximately fill capacity, permanent melting point, porosity, and apparent specific gravity for soil moisture calculation and for irrigation scheduling. Okay, by this diagram, in order to determine soil texture, first you have to know that texture in the soil consists of sand, silt, and clay. And this is for agricultural land. Agricultural land, soil in agricultural land consists of sand, silt, and clay. Say sand means soil particle with diameter greater than 0.05 millimeter. Silk, smaller size, 0.002 to 0.005. And clay is smaller than 0.002 millimeter or 2 micron. Clay is very small. Okay, when you take soil sample from your field and then use some technique to classify percent sand, silt, and clay. You can determine sand using seed to screen sand. But to determine clay, you need some special technique. It's called hydrometer technique. You have to use hydrometer technique in order to identify the amount of clay. After you know the percentage of sand, silt, clay, for example, suppose soil from your field has 20% sand, 40% silt, and 40% clay. How we can classify texture of this soil using this diagram? 20% sand, okay, scale 0 to 100, 20 sand here, like this. Then you can draw a line like this. 40% silk, this is 40%. And 40% clay intersect here. Then we classify that this soil is clay loam. So this diagram used for classification of agricultural soil. After you know the texture of the soil, then this table will give you some approximate value of field capacity here, clay loam. Clay loam has field capacity between 23 to 31% by dryness. Average 27. Permanent wilting point 11 to 15 or 13% by average. Porosity, apparent specific gravity for clay loam is average 1.35. So this table is usually given in all irrigation techniques. But if you would like to find exactly what is field capacity, permanent wilting point, porosity, apparent specific gravity, you need to bring your soil sample to laboratory and use some equipment. Okay, let me show you this. Just pass field. Okay, this one. This diagram shows relationship between soil suction in bar or atmosphere of pressure. And this scale is percent by volume. This one soil moisture in percent by weight. You see, soil moisture level has inverse relation to soil suction. Permanent wilting point is defined as the soil moisture at 15 bar, minus 15 bar. Fuel capacity is minus 0.1 bar. If you bring your soil to your laboratory, put soil sample in a soil moisture extractor and apply different soil suction, you will know how much water is available at different soil suction. And this is fuel capacity. This is permanent wilting point. Okay, come back to previous one. Okay, but anyway, if you don't want to, you don't have time to do this, you don't have equipment, then you have to use some statistic from textbook or from research paper in your country. Maybe some soil scientists, irrigation engineers already analyze soil, different type soil in your country already. But this is coming from the textbook, general textbook. Okay, this should answer you about how to determine fuel capacity. But critical point I will tell you a little bit later. Okay, after you know the formula for soil moisture calculation, I will show you some example of simple calculation in order to answer when to irrigate, how much water should be applied according to the principle of irrigation. Example number one, please determine total available water and readily available water for maize growing in loam soil with root zone depth 80 centimeters at full growth and depletion fraction. I already told you depletion fraction is ratio of readily available water to total available water. Depletion fraction 0.6 is the characteristic of maize, not soil. Okay, from table number one, soil is loam soil. Let's go back to the table. Loam is here. Fuel capacity average 22. Permanent wilting point 10% by dry mass. And loam soil has apparent specific gravity 1.4. So from table number one, loam soil, we know fuel capacity, permanent wilting point, apparent specific gravity. Then we can calculate depth of water between fuel capacity and permanent wilting point. See? Okay. Total by this formula, depth of water equal to percent by mass multiplied by apparent specific gravity multiplied by root zone depth divided by 100. This is a formula for calculate soil moisture. We want to know total available water, which is water between fuel capacity minus permanent wilting point. See, percent by dry weight is 22 minus 10. Multiply by apparent specific gravity 1.4. Root zone depth 80 centimeters. Then by this, we can calculate total available water for maize at full growth in loam soil. You see, total available water is 134.4 millimeters. readily available water equal to depletion fraction, yeah, P, multiplied by total available water. Depletion fraction 0.6 multiplied by 134.4, 80.6 millimeter. See? This is total available water. This is fuel capacity, permanent melting point, readily available water. Then we can convert into percent of soil moisture in dry mass at critical point. Now we know critical point of mist in loam soil. Critical point of mist in loam soil is 14.8. Depletion fraction is purely property of crop, but 14.8 is combined mass in loam soil. Okay, now by this you can calculate when to irrigate. Irrigate when soil moisture decrease to 14.8% by dry mass, or readily available water 80.6 is removed from the root zone. How much water should be applied? Refill back to fuel capacity. This is basic irrigation principle for most crops, except rice. Rice has different nature. Okay. Example two. I would like to introduce you more terms related to irrigation scheduling, except fuel capacity, permanent melting point, critical point, total available water, readily available water, depletion depletion fraction. Now, I would like you to know about this term, irrigation frequency, and amount of water applied. In this example, calculate irrigation frequency and the amount of water applied for maize in example number one. Given that crop evapotranspiration, ETC of maize equal 8 millimeter per day. I will discuss about crop evapotranspiration later, in the later topic. But right now, I need to use some figure about crop evapotranspiration. Crop evapotranspiration, you can call crop consumptive use or crop water requirements. Crop evapotranspiration, 8 millimeter per day is mean maize require 8 millimeter of water per day. Okay. Irrigation frequency is the ratio of readily available water, which we already calculated in the previous example. When you divide this by ETC or crop evapotranspiration, readily available water 80.6 divided by S is 10.01. Let's use irrigation frequency, 10 days per irrigation. What does it mean, irrigation frequency? It means to grow map on sandy loam, irrigate, you need irrigation every 10 days at full growth state. But when maize is smaller, irrigation frequency will be different because root zone depth may not be as much as 80 centimeters. Maybe only the first few weeks, only 10 centimeters. Total available water, readily available water will be smaller. Okay, After you calculate irrigation frequency, then you can calculate net irrigation water requirement. Net irrigation water requirement equal to crop evapotranspiration ETC multiplied by irrigation frequency. 8 multiplied by 10, 80 millimeter every 10 days, if no rain. By simple example, you will know more about irrigation frequency, net irrigation water requirement. When I said net irrigation water requirement, it means when you apply water to the field, there are some loss. You have to add more. Net irrigation plus water requirement plus some loss in order to determine the gross irrigation water requirement or the total supply to the field. Okay. By this concept, irrigation frequency, net irrigation water requirement is mean, okay, at the start of the planting, you have to apply water to bring soil moisture to field capacity. And soil moisture will drop like this, 8 millimeter per day, until it reach critical point, or until all readily available water are consumed. Then you have to irrigate. Soil moisture will bring back, you refill back to field capacity. And then after that is decreasing like this. This graph shows you something like a statistic, but actually each period is not the same. Okay. Next example is calculate irrigation frequency and the amount of water applied for maize. The same data as example 1 and 2. But assume there are some rainfall. Suppose effective rainfall is estimated 2 millimeter per day. Then irrigation frequency calculation change. Before, irrigation frequency is readily available divided by ETC. Due to effective rainfall, you have to deduct ETC by effective rainfall. Irrigation frequency from 10 days per irrigation become 13 days. And net irrigation water requirement equal to ETC minus effective rainfall multiplied by irrigation frequency. So by this example, if you have rain, you have to apply irrigation every 13 days at 78 millimeter per irrigation. But anyway, if effective rainfall greater than ETC, net irrigation effective rainfall greater than ETC, NIR or net irrigation water requirement is zero and no irrigation is needed. Okay, I will try to tell you more about irrigation principle by this example, because maybe easier to learn from example. From the previous example, if application efficiency 70%, application efficiency is mean the net irrigation requirement divided by this application efficiency EA equal to 100 multiplied by net irrigation divided by gross. This example gives you application efficiency 70%. ask you to determine cross irrigation water requirement. From previous example, NIR is 78 multiplied by 100 divided by 70. It means each irrigation you have to supply 111.4 millimeter instead of 78, because in application, water application, there are some loss taken. Loss will be more or less depend on expertise of the farmers, depend on irrigation techniques. See, okay, irrigation water loss equal to gross minus depth minus net. So each irrigation, this much of water is lost. Yeah, about 30% by this example. Okay, I will show you more. From example for if maize growing area equal 5 hectares, what is the total volume of water applied in each irrigation? See, for gross irrigation requirement 111.4 millimeter per irrigation, we can convert this into volume of water. Volume equal to depth multiplied by area. So this means in each irrigation you have to apply 5,570 cubic meter for 5 hectares. If you have smaller area, then volume will be less. If you have more area, volume will be larger. But cross irrigation water requirements the same. Okay, now suppose you want to irrigate by using pump. You have to pump water from the canal to irrigate your land. This is the formula for calculation of pumping rate and pumping time for water application. The question, the formula is easy. 360 multiplied by pumping rate Q, pumping time T in hours, pumping rate in cubic meter per second, area in hectare, application depth in millimeter. From previous example, calculate pumping hours required in each irrigation. If your pumping flow rate equal 0.1 cubic meter per second, you just substitute this Q into this equation. Area 5 hectare, D 111.4. By this, it means you have to pump 15.47 hours per irrigation. Last example, if suppose you don't have this much time for pumping for irrigation, you want to limit pumping out to 10, then you need larger size pump. Okay, you can calculate by this thing the same equation. A the same as before, D is the same. T is 10 hours. Then we can calculate Q. Substitute all figures or value into the formula. Then you get the pump flow rate, 0.15 cubic meter per second. If you want to complete your irrigation within 10 hours. If you want to reduce pumping out, pumping size has to be larger. This is a simple logic. Okay, before I finish this irrigation scheduling, is the last one. Nowadays, there are some equipment. We call it soil moisture meter or soil moisture scheduler. Like this one is called, this is very, very, very basic one. It's tensiometer. Has been used for a long time already. This one we call gypsum block. Measure resistance between these sensors. And this kind of instrument is kind of more modern, we call time domain reflectometry or frequency domain reflectometry. There are two types. But time domain reflectometry is the most modern soil moisture meter nowadays. Time domain reflectometry or TDR is the most modern and most expensive, but more accurate. Tensiometer gypsum block is cheap. Okay. If you have this instrument, now this instrument will tell you when to irrigate, because all these instruments measure soil moisture. If soil moisture drop to critical point, this sensor can send signal to pump control or to you in order to start irrigation. Okay. I think let's break for 10 minutes. Let's have a coffee, but you have to make coffee by yourself. Okay? Nobody answer.
Okay, doctor.
Okay. Let's just take 10 minute break. And you serve coffee yourself. Okay, back to the class. Are you still with me?
Yes, I think we are back.
Okay, thank you. How to pronounce your name? Thuk?
You can call me Panya.
Panya, okay. Are you from which country?
I'm from Cambodia.
Ah, I see. Nice to meet you.
Yes, nice to meet you too, doctor.
Okay. Okay, let's continue. Okay, this is this table show the looting depth and depletion fraction for all cry of crop. you can get this table from FAO publication number 56. You can go to Google and say FAO report, FAO irrigation and drainage paper number 56. I think you can find from many sources. So FAO provide a lot of information for irrigation scheduling, like this, type of crop, different type of crop, and then maximum rooting depth, depletion fraction. The table of this is very long table, not short like this. I just show you as example, like rice. Okay, or maize, okay, like this, maize, few grain. Rooting depth is between 1 to 1.7, and depletion fraction is 0.55. Yeah. Depletion fraction depends on water sensitive crop. The more sensitive, depletion fraction is low. High sensitive, depletion fraction is high. The irrigation scheduling for rice and non-rice are different. What I have been talked to you is kind of optimum irrigation scheduling for non-rice. The idea is control soil moisture level between field capacity and critical point. But for rice, the concept is different. Going right is to control soil water, not soil moisture, soil water above surface. For normal rice, usually farmer practice controlling water depth about 10 centimeters. But nowadays, we try to reduce water consumption of rice, because rice is the crop that consumes more water than any crop. So to reduce water use by rice, there is a technique invented not very long ago. It's called alternate wet and drying, wetting and drying method. AWD, alternate wetting and drying method. This kind of new technique for irrigating rice. By this alternate wetting and drying technique, some water can be saved. The technique is to control soil water at maximum of 5 centimeters. And then water in the paddy field can allow to decrease until surface is dry. And water level in paddy field is at minus 15 centimeters. So in the paddy field, there is a wetting cycle and drying cycle. Wetting means when there are some more standing water, but maximum of 5 centimeters. Drying cycle is when there is no standing water and water level in the root zone drop from 0 to 15 centimeters. By this technique, it can reduce rice consumption. But it is kind of more complicated for farmers to do it. That's why nowadays, not many farmers follow this method. In summary, to determine irrigation scheduling, when to irrigate, how much water should be applied, What we need to know is soil moisture content, crop property, crop water requirement, effective rainfall, application efficiency, and scheduling instrument. Okay, the next topic is crop water requirement. Crop water requirement. Okay, by this diagram, it shows you how we can estimate crop water requirement. Water input to crop system is by rain or irrigation. Rain and irrigation, water from rain irrigation, some will be infiltrated into the root zone. If rainfall intensity or irrigation application rate greater than infiltration rate of the soil, some water will be lost as surface runoff. Okay. After irrigation or rain, pore space will be filled with water. Soil moisture in root zone will be at saturation. And then gravitational water will be drained down to the groundwater level. Plant extract water from the root zone used in the process of transpiration. So water will be lost as transpiration from the plant leaf, and some water lost as evaporation from the surrounding area of the plant. So there are two loss take place in cropping system, in irrigation system of crop. Those are evaporation and transpiration. When we combine evaporation and transpiration, we call ET or evapotranspiration. There are three terms of evapotranspiration. The first one is ETO. ETO is reference crop ET. ETO depend on climate data only. ETO is estimate based on grass reference crop. So ETO will change according to the climate. Next ET is ETC or crop evapotranspiration. ETC equal to ETO multiplied by KC. KC is a crop coefficient, which is depend on type of crop and state of growth. KC change according to type and state of growth. When you multiply KC to ETO, we get ETC or crop evapotranspiration or crop water requirement. ETC stands for crop evapotranspiration. That's a meaning the same as crop water requirement or crop consumptive use. ETC or crop evapotranspiration is the ET that take place in the well water crop at optimal agronomic condition. But when soil moisture drop below critical point, water stress take place. Plant will reduce transpiration. In that case, ETA or actual ETA is actual evapotranspiration will be less than ETC. To determine ETA, we multiply ETC by KS. KS stands for water stress coefficient. So by definition of these three ET, we can use this to calculate about irrigation water requirement. ETO depend on climate. ETO is reference evapotranspiration rate from a reference surface. Not short of water. This one we call reference crop evapotranspiration. The reference surface is hypothetical glass reference crop with some specific characteristic, which are height of crop has to be uniform. At high 0.12 meter, surface resistance equal to 70 seconds per meter, and albedo or reflection coefficient 0.23. This is definition of reference surface. To estimate ETO for climate data, Penman Met Montes is the recommended method. And most commonly used technique for ETO calculation for climate. This is Penman Montes formula. We will not really go into this formula because too complicated for a short time lecture. But anyway, to calculate ETO, we need to know temperature, we need to know wind speed, and we need to know the radiation and humidity, relative humidity. Average ETO for different agroclimatic region. See, this is for cool area, moderate warm, and region like Thailand is in humid region. Thailand has temperature around average about, let's say, a little bit less than 30. So rough estimate of ETO is 3 to 5 millimeter per day. So you can use this to figure out the rough value of the ETO. If you don't have climatic data to calculate the ETO. This figure shows the estimate of ETO from 103 climatic station of Thailand using long-term 30-year statistic. You can see that the monthly ETO vary. This is the mean. This is minimum, and this is the maximum. So it's vary between like 70 millimeter per month to more than 170 milliliter per month. Okay. From this graph, I summarize ETO, annual ETO. Minimum for Thailand is 1,200, maximum 1,600, and mean. And average per day is 3.9. So this table can give you some guideline for the ETO if you don't have the enough data for calculation. ETC is KC multiplied by ETO. KC is the crop factor, which vary depending on type of crop and period of growth. This this graph is a kind of typical KC graph of FAO, which you can see that FAO divide going period into three periods: initial stage, crop development, mid season, late season, and KC of FAO is defined for initial stage, defined for mid season and end period. And after that, you can construct a graph or a curve representing KC at any time. This is on this concept. Okay. FAO provide a table. Table 11 from the FAO irrigation and drainage paper number 56. This table specify period of growth, initial stage, development, mid season, late season for varieties of crop. And next table, table 12. Table 12 define the 3 KC. KC of initial period, initial stage, mid season, and end period. And after you know this KC and period of growth, then you can construct KC curves. Okay, this is example of seasonal crop water requirement published by Royal Irrigation Department of Thailand. Our Royal Irrigation Department has 9 water use research stations around the country. They conduct experiments to measure crop consumptive use of different kind of crop. And this is kind of a summary of the crop water requirement or crop consumptive use for different crop, starting for different kind of rice, wheat, maize, sweet corn, until sweet potato.
Doctor, sorry, I have another question.
Okay, yes.
And according to FAO table, I cannot see about the KC of rice.
Ah, okay.
Yes, and
this table?
Is it different? I mean, different KC from the initial stage to the end because of the different varieties of rice. Like for example, some rice is from the total days of from initial stage until the end is around 115 days, and some rice is only 90 or 95 days. So the KC is different or what?
Different, but okay. The table 11 and 12 I show you here is only part of the table in irrigation and drainage paper number 56. I just cut only some parts to show.
Yes,
but if you go to this publication, table 12 may be 10 pages, varieties of crop, table 11 also, many pages. But unfortunately, according to your question, that rice has many varieties. Growth periods are not the same. But FAO has not much information about rice. Have some, but not much. Not all varieties. They just conclude rice as only one crop, one varieties. There are no other varieties for rice. But in Thailand, Royal Irrigation Department, because rice is a very important crop in our country, Royal Irrigation Department conducted many experiments to determine KC of varieties of rice. But for FAO, there is not much information, only rice only. Not specify varieties more than 100 days or less than 100 days. Maybe if you want to use this information, maybe you have to apply using information from your country.
Yes.
Like this. I show you this one kind of from the Royal Irrigation Department. Published many crops, the crop water requirement, total requirement for the season, and requirement per right. Okay, the last ET is ETA. This is very important. When we call ETC, it means ETC is crop evapotranspiration. When there is no water stress, full supply with water, crop evapotranspiration, we call ETC. But whenever soil water in the root zone drop below critical point, stress begin, and actual evapotranspiration will be less than ETC. Less than by this factor we call water stress coefficient KS. See, ETA equal to KS, KS less than 1, so ETA less than ETC. Okay. Water stress coefficient, I would like to explain this stress coefficient in order to determine ETA by this diagram. See. Okay, soil moisture level, fuel capacity, critical point, permanent wilting point. This is optimal for irrigation. If you can control soil moisture between these two, stress will not take place. And actual evapotranspiration equal ETC. Okay. Based on this soil moisture level, okay, we have soil moisture level here. Soil moisture and fuel capacity, permanent critical point, permanent wilting point. Or we can show by the other scale we call depletion fraction. Fuel capacity, depletion fraction equal zero. If moisture level at permanent wilting point, depletion fraction is at 1. When soil moisture is at critical point, depletion fraction equal to P. Ks, when soil moisture is between these, Ks equal 1. And when stress take place, Ks drop from 1 to 0 at permanent wilting point. According to this diagram, I write down equation for Ks. Ks equal to 1 if soil moisture depletion less than RAW. It means soil moisture depletion within this zone. Ks equal 1. If soil moisture level drop below RAW, greater than RAW, Ks equal to TAW minus soil moisture depletion divided by total available water minus readily available water. Or by this diagram, suppose soil moisture is now here, delta 1. If soil moisture here below critical point. This means soil moisture depletion equal to this. The line intersect the curve, and then you can see this is Ks. Ks less than 1. If soil moisture level drop to here, Ks equal 0. If soil moisture is at critical point, Ks equal 1. Or can write into it, can show equation by this. Or if equation is written in term of soil moisture, you can use the second equation, the same. Okay. FLO irrigation and drainage paper 56 also given depletion fraction P for different kind of crop, varieties of crop here. Also, this is only example for small vegetable. Table 12 has many pages, maybe almost 100 crops presented in this FAO irrigation and drainage paper. Okay, the last part is, if you can control soil moisture between field capacity and critical point, stress coefficient equal 1. If you can connect here, if Ks equal 1, it means ETA, ratio of ETA to ETC equal 1. Or 1 minus ratio of ETA to ETC. This one we call reduction in evapotranspiration. This one is ratio of actual to ETC, actual ET to ETC. But this scale is mean reduction in evapotranspiration. 1 minus ETA minus ETC. What does it mean by if you control soil moisture level here between field capacity and critical point, Ks equal 1, ETA to ETC equal 1, evapotranspiration reduction is equal to 0. And by this, we can determine crop yield response by this equation. This equation said 1 minus YA divided by Y max. YA is actual yield. YM is maximum yield. 1 minus this ratio is mean yield reduction. Yield reduction equal to yield response factor KY multiplied by ET reduction. The idea is if soil moisture level drop below critical point, ETA less than ETC, there are some reduction in ETC or reduction in transpiration process, and that affects the yield of crop. So yield response formula is this one. So from this, suppose soil moisture level drop to here, below critical point, Ks equal 0.7. And then ETO reduction is about 30%. So this term is 30%, 0.3. And KY, yield response factor, depend on type of crop and growth period. Water sensitive crop, KY is high. Water less sensitive crop, KY is low. For example, like this. If KY equal to evapotranspiration reduced by 0.3 or 30%. And crop pest KY equal to, it means yield reduction is 60%. But if KY equal 0.5, this is a low sensitive, water sensitive crop. Yield reduction is only 15%. So what I try to say is, if you can control irrigation within optimum range, it will not reduce yield. But if soil moisture level drop below that because of irrigation is not sufficient, or because of you don't have sufficient water to supply, then that will affect yield of the crop. And this is table on KY, the different type of crop also. It's also given in FAO irrigation and drainage paper 56. Okay, this is just to show you how to make some simple calculations. From the previous example, so I have total available water, 134.4, depletion fraction, ETC, 2 millimeter per day. Okay. And suppose that soil moisture depletion greater than, okay, let's say from the given data, RAW equal to 0.6. And suppose we allow soil moisture drop below critical point, soil moisture depletion equal to 0.72 multiplied by total available water greater than RAW. Then KS by this calculation equal to 0.7. ETA to ETC equal to 0.7. Yield reduction 30%. If KY equal to, okay, yield reduction is 0.6, or actual yield is equal to 0.4 of the maximum yield. To do irrigation scheduling, usually you should monitor soil moisture level. This is soil moisture depletion. This is day after planting. And this is total available moisture for different period of growth. And this is readily available. If you can control soil moisture like this, this is quite good. Even sometimes it's dropped below critical point, but only a little bit. But if you have this kind of soil moisture depletion, some period soil moisture drop a lot below RA, readily available water, like this, this will affect yield of the crop. Okay, there is one computer program. I think it is good one for the people who first start about irrigation principle. This program called CropWatch version number 8. CropWatch has been developed long time ago, more than 30 years, from the DOS version until last version, version 8. This version also developed long time ago, but not improved after 8. You can download this program from this website. FAO website, Land Water, Database and Software, CropWatch English. Okay, let me ask you, are there anybody familiar with CropWatch before? No? Or yes?
Not really.
Not really.
I just heard about crop board, but never use it.
Okay. Okay. What we have now, maybe about half an hour. If you are interested, I will show you how to use crop board in a very brief. Because what I have been explained, it will be more clear if you know how to use crop board. Crop board is a very good program to explain about irrigation principle that I have been discussed to you. Okay, let's stop from this for a while. Okay, this is crop board program. It's free download from FAO website. Okay, crop board is easy to use. Okay, there is a main menu of crop board here, starting from calculate ETO, calculate effective landform, input crop coefficient and crop property, input soil property. After you have finished the first form, then you can calculate crop water requirement, similar to the theory I already discussed to you. And then you can do irrigation scheduling here. Irrigation scheduling is mean when to irrigate, how much water should be applied. Crop board can simulate the situation when to irrigate, how much water should be applied for the whole season. And then if you want to calculate scheme water supply, you have to input cropping pattern. Okay, we will spend maybe a few minutes starting from here like this. Okay, let's before we go to that, I would like to show you this here. There is an option like this. To calculate ETO, there are some data unit option. Calculate effective landform, there is five option. Use fixed percentage, dependable rain developed by FAO, or using empirical formula from your research, or use USDA formula, or you don't take into account of rain. Use last option. And then non-rice crop scheduling, irrigation timing, irrigation application, rice scheduling, the same. There are options on irrigation timing and irrigation application, and the land preparation for rice. Okay. So first you have to know how to set option. Then go to main menu on the left. Okay, first one, climate ETO. It means to calculate potential evapotranspiration by climatic or by climate data. Okay, this is a blank sheet. You can input data here, or you can look at the database given by our crop board program. Okay, Kun Kernun Station. Okay, when you open data, Kernun Station, is in latitude 15.8, latitude 78 is on the west of Thailand. Altitude quite high, 281 meters. This is the input data. Minimum temperature, maximum temperature, humidity, wind speed, sunshine hours. And then the program of what we calculate. Radiation and ETO for each month. For this station, according to climate, ETO is 5.36 millimeter per day. Okay, after you retrieve the ETO, climatic data, and calculate ETO. Then you can look at rainfall. Open data. This data already given in the crop watch. Okay, this is monthly rain. Effective rainfall. By fixed percentage. You can change the option here. Now you choose this option, fixed percentage. 80% of rain is effective. But if you don't like, you can change to others. But okay, you may try by yourself later. Then go to crop. Empty table. You can open and select. Maybe suppose sugarcane. This is growth state. Sugarcane has one annual crop. You see, this is the period of growth state. And this is KC. Name of the crop. You can change all this. And you can modify this. All this data. Rooting depth. This is maximum rooting depth. Critical depletion. Critical depletion fraction or P. Yield response factors 0.5. Crop height. So this is the P for different period. This is KY for different period and crop height of sugarcane. Okay. Planting date, you can change. But this one is not right because the growth period is 1 year. Let me change like this. Suppose, okay, you start planting. 1st January, the harvest is automatically calculated end of the year. And then you can input soil. You can just input manually like this or open data. Okay, let's say medium soil. Here is total available moisture or ATAW. Maximum land infiltration rate. Maximum rooting depth. Initial soil moisture depletion. Zero is mean water is now, soil moisture is at field capacity. Initial available moisture equal to ATM. It means root zone is full. Of moisture. Calculate crop water requirement. Using data from kernel. Using rainfall from kernel average. Crop sugarcane. Soil medium. Planting date 1st of January. Then from this, then you can calculate. ETC, in millimeter per day and millimeter per deck. Deck is mean 10 day. Decade 10 day. And this is effective rainfall for every 10 days. Irrigation water requirement, net irrigation water requirement for every 10 days from the 1st January to December.
Yeah.
And this one called decade, 1, 2, 3. 1 month has 3 decades. Okay. Then we can go to scheduling. See, irrigation schedule. This one calculate net irrigation, cost irrigation, efficiency 70%. Irrigation timing, irrigate at critical depletion. Application, irrigation application, refill soil to fill capacity. This is optimum irrigation scheduling. And then at the end of the table, there are some conclusion about total gross irrigation, total net irrigation loss, total rainfall, effective rainfall, and dew response. Cumulative dew reduction 0 is mean. Yeah. This is soil moisture depletion. You can see that how we control soil moisture level above critical point. That's why dew reduction is equal to 0. Okay, suppose you input crop pattern, I would like to say test and select sugar cane specify planting date, specify area, support our area has 100% sugarcane. Then you can, I have to save it first. Sorry. Now then you can calculate irrigation water requirement. In each month of sugarcane, irrigation water requirement for actual area in liter per second per hectare. Okay, this is crop one, which I think it will be useful for people who would like to know irrigation principle. Okay, let's. Now there is a modern technique. It's more modern than crop what is. You can use satellite to monitor crop condition. Satellite can monitor crop condition using the NDVI. NDVI stands for normalized different vegetation index. You can see that satellite can get some signal from different plant condition, dead plant, stress plant, healthy plant, using NDVI. NDVI equal to near infrared minus stress minus red wave divided by near infrared plus red. And then from NDVI, it can be show the health and growth of crop. Healthy crop, NDVI may be high, like 0.72. For stress crop, NDVI is low. So by this condition, and this is scale of NDVI, dead plant, 0 to minus 1, unhealthy, moderate, healthy. Then we can use this for irrigation scheduling also. ILISAT is web application. ILISAT stands for Irrigation Plus Satellites. It's called cloud-based irrigation service. The whole idea is satellite will measure NDVI and convert into KC. And weather station measure climate parameter and calculate ETO. ETO multiplied by KC equal to ETC. So ILISAT provide information about KC and also ETO if you are in Australia. But if you are out of Australia, then you don't access to ETO data. You have to set up weather station and calculate ETO by yourself. And you use KC from satellite to estimate cold water requirement. This is kind of modern technique, which is quite good. Anybody know ILISAT? Panja? Maybe you are ready for lunch, eh? Okay, actually I have a lot to discuss to you, but time is almost over. I will go fast to the end. This is concept of ILISAT. Finally, you can calculate ETO. And ILISAT can forecast ETO 8 days in advance. And this is the my web application. It's called iWASM, developed by my department. iWASM stands for Intelligent Water Allocation and Monitoring System. You can access to this iWASM by this website. You cannot download or done anything. It is not complete yet, just to show. But iWASM nowadays was developed using Thai language for Thai people. But if you would like to read it, you have to specify after the URL, you put question mark, and put LANG, stand for language, equal to ENG, English. Then it will change the presentation from Thai to English. This is concept of iWASM. The iWASM has the main menu, calculate irrigation water requirement, irrigation efficiency, generate water delivery report, forecast data, measurement station. We set up two measurement station. One is a weather station and a flow measurement station in our research area. Okay, how to apply water? This is method of irrigation. Okay, the common method of irrigation nowadays is surface irrigation, sprinkler irrigation, micro irrigation, and subsurface irrigation. Surface irrigation, the common surface irrigation method are furrow, border, and basin. Common sprinkler irrigation is fixed system, big gun, center pivot, lateral move, and micro irrigation. There are varieties also, like drip, micro spray. Subsurface can be open ditch or burly pipe. But right now, there are a lot of modern technique for water application. Not water, but maybe solution application. That technique are greenhouse technique, hydroponics, aeroponics, aquaponics. Plant factory now become more attractive, particularly for the large metropolitan area. And the most advanced is nanofarm. Nanofarm is mean you can develop farm in your kitchen. That's why it's called nanofarm. It's really new idea, but really advanced. But this diagram show irrigation area and irrigation method in different countries. Red represent localized irrigation, like India. India has a lot, a very large irrigation area, maybe largest, India, China. But mostly are green surface. Some sprinkle, some localized. China is about the same, except has more sprinkle and more localized irrigation. United States has maybe the most advanced for sprinkle irrigation. Spain, all three techniques are about the same. Israel is most advanced in micro irrigation. Thailand is here. You cannot see blue or red because most of irrigation method is surface. Indonesia, even though in Thailand we have some sprinkler use, but in very, very small. Also, we have micro irrigation also. Like Thailand, our neighbor, Vietnam, Indonesia, not very far, yeah, dominated by surface irrigation. So, surface irrigation is the method that has been practiced by most farmers in the world, divided into border, furrow, and basin. Okay. Some consideration on surface, advantage and disadvantage. Sprinkle. This method is like a raining, imitate rain. Different kind of sprinkler irrigation. This is typical sprinkler irrigation in advanced country like in USA. When you fly by plane, you can see a big green circle like this. This is a area that you sprinkle irrigation by center pivot system. Now there is some application to control. But if sprinkle irrigation is require high investment. Important consideration, advance and disadvantage. Micro irrigation, the same. Application efficiency for different irrigation technique. And this is modern, like I told you. I would like to just say a little bit about nano farm here. That's why I said this bring farm into your kitchen. Be advanced. Okay, lastly, there's some example about modern irrigation technology. The most modern canal system is in Australia. Modernized canal in Northern Victoria. This project can increase conversion efficiency from 65 to 85. Using new developed gate called Rubicon. Like canal by plastic. Have automatic water ordering system. The whole system is controlled. That's why water loss can be reduced. In this system, 12,000 automated gate and meter were installed in 1,875 miles of the main canal. Here, typical irrigation efficiency before is 65, it can improve to 85, 20%. Comparison cost, capital cost, operating cost, distribution efficiency, response, and overall performance of gravity channel. Gravity manual, gravity automated like used in Australia, or gravity pipeline, pressurized pipeline. The most cost effective is this one, gravity channel automated. These are another new innovation about micro irrigation. It's called EnDrip. EnDrip integrate gravity power, it's called gravity power micro irrigation solution. Instead of using high heads, this EnDrip using head less than 2 meters and use this at the head tank. You can find more information from the link. Water Energy Nexus. India is the first country that generate electricity by solar cell put cover the canal. This can reduce evaporation. But some researcher, some scientists said it will affect quality of water. United States have a plan to do the same thing. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Varavut. You can hear me, right?
Already go for lunch.
Okay, so I'm not sure that anyone has a question. I'm not sure, or maybe most people just like ready to for lunch, maybe. Okay, so if you have a question, you can put the question on the chat box, or just like have a question later, you can just like email us or put it in the Google Classroom as well. Just go to the post and then put the question, and Dr. Varavut will answer the question that you asked. So if No one has a question for today. We are going to end the session for today. And tomorrow we will come back again with the same time with the topic about the climate change and water resources. So we will see each other for tomorrow. For today, thank you very much. Thank you, Ajahn Varawut.
Thank you, everybody.